Good afternoon. My name is Alexander Green. I am a English and Spanish major here. I'm a sophomore. Well, Peter H. Hassrick is Director Emeritus and Senior Scholar at the Buffalo Bill Center of the West in Cody, Wyoming. He's also Director Emeritus of the Petrie Institute of the Western American Art at the Denver Art Museum, founding Director Emeritus of Charles M. Russell Center at the University of Oklahoma, and founding Director of the Georgia O'Keeffe Museum in Santa Fe, New Mexico. He earned a BA in History at the University of Colorado and an MA in Art History at the University of Denver. He's the author and or co-author of numerous books, including Frederick Remington, The Masterworks, The Rocky Mountains, A Vision for Artists in the 19th Century, The American West in Bronze, and most recently, Drawn to Yellowstone, Artists in America's First National Park. Please give a warm welcome to Peter H. Hassrick.
Hey, greetings from Wyoming. That's no G, Wyoming. These guys that came yesterday, they're a hard act to follow. Jeez, I wouldn't blame you if everybody was in the back row ready to sneak out after the lights go out. Because this is an art history lecture and the lights will go out. I learned a lot yesterday. I hope all you, are you repeats? There's just a whole new crowd that wants to learn about art. All right, I learned from Bill that you don't, if you're tenured at Harvard, you don't have to write any more books. Yeah, I learned from Michael that David Crockett actually was against the Indian Removal Act that jerk Jackson tried to push through, or did push through. So, go David! All right. And I learned from Matt how to pronounce the name of the state I grew up in. You know, I moved from Philadelphia, my parents did, to Denver. He took a job at the Denver Art Museum, my father. And they call it Colorado. My mother said Colorado. So I call it Colorado, too. And now I'm taught that it's Colorado. And when I moved to Texas to take my first job at the Amon Carter Museum as a curator, they looked at me and said, "Are you from England?" Or they listened to my voice, and I said, no, I'm from Colorado. So I should have caught on early enough that maybe that was the problem. But I moved out of Texas as soon as my kids start sounding like Texans. So we're going to, if I can figure this out. Oh yeah, this is a trigger. I never had one of these before. This is cool. We're looking at two artists here. I'm going to learn you something. I've learned a lot, and I'm going to learn you guys about these two artists, Frederick Remington on the left and Charles Russell on the right. Of all the temptations that scholars and aficionados and students and collectors of Western American art have, the biggest temptation is the wish to compare and contrast these two artists. So these are the titans of American Western art at the end of the 19th and early 20th century. And they were the most celebrated regionally and nationally in their day as the artists of the West, okay? Some people really like Remington a lot. So this is the Remington wing over here. And some people really like Russell, so you guys are the Russell people today. And then there are a group of people who don't like either of them, I guess you guys are in the middle. So we'll try to get you all to either pick one or the other or join this middle group. There are not very many seats left there, but hopefully we can get you there. And we're going to start with a few biographical insights into these guys. This is Remington. He was born in upstate New York in 1861. His father was a journalist, went to Cornell to study journalism. But it was 1861, and he volunteered to be in the cavalry, in the Union cavalry. He was a rabid abolitionist. He sponsored what's his name? John C. Fremont, who was the abolitionist presidential candidate in 1858. So he really wanted to abolish slavery. And Frederick grew up in that kind of a household with a journalist father. His father also had horse farms he raised and horses. And so Remington was very involved in horses in his growing up years. Remington went off to a military academy, to Burlington Military Academy in Vermont when he was maybe a junior in high school. And when he graduated from there, he went to Yale instead of Cornell. And Yale had a young art school. And so he wanted to study and be an artist. He didn't want to be a journalist, though he turned out to be quite a capable writer. He went to art school for a year and a half, and then his father prematurely died. And his uncle and his one of his uncles and his mother decided maybe you ought to come out of school. We maybe can't afford that any longer. And so his uncle got him a job in the insurance business. And that lasted about a year. And when he had a vacation, he ran off to Montana to try life on a ranch, he said. And came back and did some more insurance work. And then when he came to be 21, he inherited a little money. And he went west and bought a ranch and started his western life. He married his childhood girlfriend from Gloversville, New York, Emma Caton, in the mid-1880s. He sold a ranch that he bought with his patrimony and invested it in several businesses in Kansas City, promptly lost his shirt. And then he decided, what am I going to do? And he said, well, maybe I ought to fall back on this quasi-talent I have in art. And so he went and studied art at the Art Students League in New York for a couple of months. And that was his total training, a year and a half at Yale and 3 or 4 months at the Art Students League. He then started painting. You see a picture of him as a young man in his late 20s. 1889 is the date of that photograph. And then you see him more substantial girth in his 40s, mid-40s, in front of his studio in fireplace in New Rochelle, New York, where he lived north of the city because he was an illustrator and he had to get in and out of the city easily. And later on, he built a house in New Rochelle, New York. He busted an appendix. And they operated on him in his kitchen table, and peritonitis set in, and he couldn't save him. And he was 48 years old when he left us in 1909. So right at the height of his career, and we'll see some of his late pictures, what an incredible talent he was. Charlie Russell grew up in a very affluent family in St. Louis. He was born 3 years after Remington in 1863. He was not a very good student. And as a consequence, they sent him to Burlington Military Academy, but it was a different one. It wasn't one in Vermont, it was one in New Jersey. That's even worse. He didn't like it a bit, and he finally, when he came home for summer vacation, he talked his parents into sending him west to work on a ranch, just like Remington had done when he was a young kid. And so they said, yeah, we know a guy named Pike Miller who has a ranch out there. It turned out to be a sheep ranch. And Russell hated sheep. And he spent a miserable year. And he came back home. He says, I don't know if I like the West, but maybe if I gave me one more try, maybe I could be a cowboy and go on a cattle ranch. And he worked himself back into the West and got a job on a cattle ranch. And he worked for 11 years. As a wrangler, a night wrangler. He really wasn't a cowboy, he was a wrangler. But he rode with the cowboys, he lived the life of the cowboy. And then in the 90s, he retired from being a cowboy, fell in love with Nancy Cooper, his bride, and they moved to a little clapboard house in Great Falls, Montana. In 1903 or 4, he built this log cabin studio. You see him proudly standing in his studio space. And he lived into his 60s. He died in 1926 in Pasadena, California, where he built a house just like Remington had built his house in Ridgefield, Connecticut late in his life. But Charlie never got to live in it. He had a bad heart. He'd smoked all his life. Can you imagine smoking roll 'em up cigarettes all your life? Anyway, what were these guys' aspirations? They both, you know, Remington wanted to be a cowboy, and this is his ranch. And he's dressed up like a cowboy. So the dream, as the one historian has said, read into this wanting to be a cowboy business. He says, this is a heroic individual seeking epic forms of action in an unrestrained wilderness or ... the dream of every adolescent male in the whole 19th century. He wanted to be an illustrator, and he worked with some of the great writers of his time and with all the major magazines, Harper's Monthly, Harper's Weekly, Collier's, Century, you name the major circulation magazines of the day, and he was the man of the West. This is a picture of Owen Wister. We heard his name the other night, the author of The Virginian. They were very close. They wrote and collaborated on stories together, and this is a story that they wrote together and illustrated in 1895. He wanted to be a war correspondent, an artist correspondent, to ride shoulder to shoulder with the cavalry. He wanted to sit around and eat breakfast with the soldiers, and he wanted to ride on their expeditions into the mountains. The only war that was going on in America at the time was the Apache Wars in Arizona, and you see him riding with the 9th Cavalry, a black Buffalo Soldier outfit, this particular battalion was run by Lieutenant Powhatan Clark, and you see him in the foreground, and you see Remington in the background with a pith helmet. You make that out? Raise your hand if you can't. He wanted to be an academic painter, and he started showing his paintings at the National Academy of Design in New York City as early as 1888. This is a painting that he showed in 1889 called A Dash for the Timber. And it was the painting the New York Times said that the largest crowd of the whole visit on the opening night, that's where they stood, standing spellbound before the dash for the timber. He wanted to be a sculptor. In 1895, he starts with the piece on the left, which is the Bronco Buster. Over 250 castings were made of this in his lifetime. And he did 24 different bronzes in the course of his career, including the Cheyenne in about 1903 or 4. He wanted to be a writer like his father. He wrote 107 stories, and they were many of them serialized in books, and those were published in about 7 different books, and then he wrote also novels like the 3 that you see on the screen, and the one of John Erman and the Yellowstone was made into a Broadway play. And he wanted to be an independent painter. At the end of his career, he didn't think it was the end of his career, but what ended up to be the end of his career, he started painting pictures devoid of being illustrated. He wanted to make a living selling his paintings and his sculptures in a gallery setting and not to be dependent on the magazines. So that was his aspirations. Charlie Russell's were exactly the same. He wanted to be a cowboy. You can read into it all those things that we mentioned. There he is with his arms folded, but there he is also with his cowboy outfit right here. A little out of focus, but you can see that figure is Charlie Russell sitting there in Utica, Montana. He wanted to be an illustrator. He considered himself really a simple illustrator all his life. That's what he said he was. He wasn't a great painter, but he turned out to be quite a great painter. His illustrations were wonderful, but so were his paintings, and they were very accomplished. This is a painting called Bringing Home the Spoils, done in around 1909. He wanted to be a sculptor. When he saw Frederick Remington's sculptures, he said, I can do that well, or maybe better. He cast and copyrighted 53 sculptures in his lifetime, including the 2 on the screen. He wanted to be a writer. He was an anecdotal storyteller, and so his stories were published originally in the Rawhide Rawlins series, 2 little books, and then after his widow published Trails Plowed Under after he died, which was an anthology of those. And his letters home were just incredible, his letters to his friends. Excuse me. The one on the bottom, he had a show of his work in London, and right next door to his exhibition was an exhibition of Italian futurist paintings. And so he went in to meet Mr. Russolo, his Italian equivalent, Russell and Russolo meet. And he looked at this painting by Russolo, and Russolo was explaining what it's all about. And He writes his friend back in Great Falls, Montana. He says, it looked like my stomach feels after a duck lunch. So those letters were published in 1929 by his widow also in Good Medicine. And he wanted to be an independent painter, and he one-upped Remington, because Remington never got a commission to do a mural, and this painting behind me is about that big, maybe a little bigger in its original size, and it hangs in the State House of Representatives in Helena, Montana. It's Lewis and Clark treating with the Blackfeet, or the Flathead Indians, a major episode in Montana history. So, they want the same things. They got there a little differently, and poor Mr. Remington didn't stay around to compete with Mr. Russell for quite as long as he wished, as we all wished. Now, as they presented the facts of the West, because they went out to sort of see the facts of the West, they also presented the myths of the West, and these are three sort of myths that they perpetuated in their work quite frequently. One of them is the equation of masculinity with lawlessness and violence and savagery and abandon and restraint. And you can see it in Mr. Remington's painting called The Quarrel on the left. He got all the crispy bacon. And you can see it in Russell's painting, Smoke of a 45 on the left. Somebody didn't pay their bar tab. So, but that's essentially what these are about. But on the converse, absolute converse of that, they also, in their lives and in their careers, wanted to present the West as an Eden, as an unspoiled, untamed a wilderness, a timeless kind, a land of timelessness and abundance. And in the case of Russell on the right, a painting called The Salute to the Fur Trade, about its exploitation too, how it could be exploited and riches taken from it. So, if you look at the Remington painting on the left, which is called The Gossips, notice how the men in that scene sort of blend with nature. They blend with the background. They are one, metaphorically, with the background. And the teepees in the background reflected in the river that goes through, and the river flowing through is a symbol of continuity and continuance and rebirth in 19th century literature and 19th century art. And the teepees give a sense of orchestration, the musical kind of quality to this scene. So these were things we don't look at when we look at paintings like this usually, but the 19th century, they read them just exactly the way they were. Okay, so we learned that. We don't have time to do that all today. That's all art history stuff. We're just touching the tip of it here. They also, one of the things we learned yesterday was a sense of fatalism, the end of the frontier, 1890, it was all over. And Remington and Russell both began to paint pictures from the very beginning of their career about the fatalism, about the end of the pioneers, about the end of the Indians, about the vanishing West, those kind of themes. And they appear as metaphors in paintings like the ones we see behind us, The Last Lull in the Fight by Remington on the left, and The Desperate Stand by Russell on the right. And this painting on the left by Remington, The Fall of the Cowboy, and the end of the open range. What's the cowboy done? He's gotten off his horse, the ultimate emasculation for a cowboy, is to have to get off your horse. And then to walk up to a fence and have to open a fence because there's a bunch of damn barbed wire, when you used to be able to just ride across this land until you couldn't ride any longer. That was quite a statement. And so this is, and it's snowy and it's cold. This is the end of the cowboy. So people talked about the vanishing Native American. Remington did that, and he also talked about the vanishing cowboy as well. So the end of the frontier, they were living at that period when things were coming to a conclusion in the public and popular mind. And they played to that. Russell's is a little more complex. That talks about the Indian as a vanishing American. But the buffalo are walking through a river, and they're regenerated. That's a symbol of regeneration. It was painted in 1911. Do you know how many buffalo were left in the United States in 1911? 300. No, probably less than that. Probably more like 75. They were mostly in Yellowstone Park, and they were being poached. So at any rate, what do these guys think of themselves? What was his self-image? Russell viewed himself as an ordinary man. You can see this in the comic little clay model of himself that he made, somehow blessed with extraordinary skills. His friends were mostly men, but from all classes. You see, his Indian friend is standing next to him, and behind him is the Chinese cook from his cowboy days, and around him are all the common people who populate the American West of his era. And he says at the bottom, "I savvy these folks. These are his people." Well, Mr. Remington never considered himself as ordinary. How can you tell? His friends were also mostly male. They were mostly from the upper class professionals in New York City, a group of lawyers and bankers got together to buy the painting on the upper right and give it to the Metropolitan Museum and give Mrs. Remington, after Frederick died, a little bit of helpful cash. And you notice the painting on the bottom. This was the first time he ever submitted a major painting to the National Academy of Design. The year before the Dash for the Timber, this is called The Alert. Who is this guy? He's an unknown Buffalo soldier. He's an unknown African-American soldier. And this is the quintessential man of Remington's day. And notice how important he is to Remington. He's the only person in the scene, and he sits there, his body and the horse way above the horizon line. He has a major presence in this man's world. So these were his friends. Russell paints a lot of genre scenes that are kind of views of ordinary life. This, you don't think this is kind of ordinary. It probably was pretty ordinary. A dude comes to town, the cowboys get a little snorted up and make him dance. But, right there, that's Charlie Russell. He's an unseen observer of the foibles of mankind. He wants to be a witness to the scene, but he doesn't want to be given credit for having been there. Remington, on the other hand, sees himself as shoulder to shoulder with the men who are doing epic things in an epic time, in an epic war. This is the Spanish-American War. Remington is an artist correspondent, embedded in a sense with Roosevelt's men, and there's Teddy Roosevelt charging up the hill. This painting was intended for Teddy Roosevelt to buy. He never did. That stayed in Remington's collection. But this is the kind of scene that Remington's sort of self-image of Remington. These are the kind of men. He played football at Yale. Looks like an end run to me. And Roosevelt never rode a horse. But it's a good scene. How did they view Indian people? Russell saw Indians as companions in an exotic world. That's called the West. They were worthy friends. They were ideal children of nature, or citizens of nature. They were noble fellow resistors of progress and civilization. This is very important for Russell. They resisted civilization. We'll see this a little bit later. Remington and his early work saw the Indian as antagonists and as resistors and malevolent forces against the progress, against manifest destiny, about the spread of civilization into the West. They got in the way. They were noble in their efforts to defend their land. He gave them that much, but they were sort of in the way of civilization's spread. Later in his life, he came around to a very different perspective. His sympathies turned toward a genuine affection of Native people on their own grounds, and he glorified them, if rather idealistically, in paintings like this, The Outlier, and in paintings like these two, The Gossips and The Love Call. So he changes in his later pictures to this kind of perception. They had both very different ideas of how to solve the, quote, Indian problem. Remington said, well, these men are all from warrior societies out here on the plains, the Sioux Indians and the Cheyenne and the Comanches and so forth. So put them in the army. That's what they wanted to do. That'll solve the problem. Russell was a little more enlightened. he was great friends with many Native peoples, particularly the Blackfeet people who lived in his neighborhood. You see him here on the left screen with two friends of his from the Blackfeet Reservation up near Glacier Park. He also worked very hard. There were a number of Cree people who lived in the Great Falls area who were sort of homeless. They didn't have a home. And so he worked with a couple of other politicians and got a reservation called the Rocky Boy Reservation, set aside federal lands for the Cree Indians to move into. Together, you know, they only ever knew the reservation Indian. Remington saw them as not just people downtrodden on the reservation, but as proud and forthright people, and the Comanche Indian on his horseback painted in Fort Sill, Oklahoma in 1888 gives you that sense of a real person and not sort of a stereotype. Does that make sense? And Russell, he knew reservation people too, but he always gave them an overlay of historicity. So this is the kind of a guy who could be hanging around the reservation, but he paints him as a guy guarding the fort. Instead, he gives him a sort of an overlay of historicism. How did they see nature? Well, they saw nature, Russell saw nature as a vast reservoir of symbol and moral associations in its purest form, and one which he really relished. Nature was a symbol of continuity, of survival over mankind. And so the painting, the sculpture, little sculpture of Mountain Mother gives you a sense of generations of wildlife that are continue. The same theme and metaphor is seen in the buffalo are coming down to the Missouri to drink. The bull, the cow, the calf, they're all getting nourished in the rich waters of the river, the Missouri River. The little sculpture on the bottom left is, however, that his sense of mankind and man's contribution to the whole thing. And it's titled, To Noses That Read, A Smell That Spells Man. It isn't good. Remington viewed nature as a symbol of finality. His landscape backgrounds are voids, usually. Russell perceived nature as a beautiful and bountiful place in this painting called When the Land Belonged to God, before man ever came here. This is how beautiful and incredible the West was. Remington saw it as just another malevolent force. These poor cowboys, as this is called, the fight for the waterhole, and they are around like the hands on a clock. Time is running out, the West is vanishing, and the landscape isn't helping any at all. Soon as if they survive the Indians that are on the fringe there, the water's going to dry up sure as hell. Well, that's until his last years. Then he became sympathetic with the landscape as well as the Indians, and he started painting landscapes in an impressionist mode. The painting above is from Cody. He painted that as a study that might be used in a larger painting. He painted the one below it as a finished impressionist landscape. It's signed and dated and would be exhibited with his other sort of narrative paintings. And the painting on the right, the larger one, was painted in Fort Robinson, Nebraska, where he'd gone to see his famous Buffalo soldiers and to paint them at the end of the 19th century in the late 1890s. And he paints this picture to take back, because it preserves the light and the topography and the look of the West, and then he'd paint an action scene in the foreground. So it's an incomplete painting. So what about time, a sense of time? Where were these guys? Well, they both went West. We heard earlier that they both went West to participate, to find their manhood, to run a ranch, to be cowboys, to be something in the West. And their art reflects that, such as the painting here by Russell of the called Cowboy Sport. They're roping a wolf. But Russell had a really different kind of take on it than Remington. Russell espoused, and I mentioned this before, the moral superiority of the past over the future. And you can see this in this painting. It's called a fireboat. And what's a fireboat? It's just a steamship. But this is the first steamboat that's come up the Missouri River. And these Indians are sort of flabbergasted by the sight of it and the noise of it. But look where he's placed it. It's not the subject of the scene. It's the subject of their demise. It's the subject of a thing that shouldn't have ever happened. Okay, so he marginalizes industry, he marginalizes the coming of the white man, and these are the people he puts on the pedestal, and these are the people he highlights with a brilliant, beautiful background of blue sky. These were his people. So Remington went west in search of epic presence. He met this guy, Carter Johnson, and painted two pictures of him, and he learned that a couple of years before this, Carter Johnson had been involved in the Cheyenne Wars and had been a hero, mounting a bulwark in one of the battles, and so he paints a battle scene of his friend in war. That's what he wanted to celebrate in the present. And then he goes and paints scenes like this, which is out of his imagination, what the cavalry charge might have looked like in the 1860s. Both these guys loved horses. I told you Remington's father raised horses. He loved to ride. He rode every day, just about. Russell rode every day. So they had their personalities identified with horses. They both sort of disdained modern life in that way. Anything that would be interference to a horse, a car, or a bicycle was disdainful. And they went to celebrate the present tense, as you see in the cavalry charge of the 9th Cavalry here on the left by Remington, and Charlie Russell's kind of naive portrayal of a roundup scene in Utica, Montana, when he was just beginning as a painter. And they both went away celebrating a glorified past. In 1901, when the painting, The Old Stagecoach of the Plains, was produced by Remington, the stagecoach itself was an anachronism. Cars were coming in, trains had replaced it. It was, nobody rode in a coach anymore. But he puts it on a pedestal. He celebrates it in this nocturne. It's a passing thing. It's a quiet goodbye to this great epic of our Western transportation history. Russell does the same thing in The Romance Makers that was painted in around 1920. He never knew a mountain man, but he did paint these pictures of pictures like this. Of the mountain man coming onto the plains, an unknown, unexplored domain. And a little bit about their training. I said Yale. He'd gone to Yale. Remington had gone to Yale. There's his classroom. His teacher was a guy named John Niemeyer. He's a French-trained painter. When he went to the Art Students League, his teacher was J. Alden Weir, who had trained at the Julian Academy in Paris. He had the Metropolitan Museum just down the street from him. He could go see Meissonier's painting of the Friedland, which had been given to the museum in a couple of years earlier. And he could pattern his paintings after that. He and Russell both refused to go to Europe to study. They both, I think, felt the same way, and that if they left America, it would spoil them somehow. It's not just un-American, it's kind of un-Western. And we'll develop our own character, our own personality as painters and sculptors, and we'll do our own thing as American artists. Charlie Russell did the same thing. He never had any training. But he had something to look at, and those are the works of Carl Weimar. Weimar was a generation earlier. He lived in St. Louis. Many of the prominent families that the Russell family would have known had Weimar paintings like this one, and he adopted the compositions and the spirit and the themes of some of these paintings into his own work. But his real major influence was none other than Frederick Remington. That painting we saw Remington painting on his easel when he was a young man in his 20s, this is a painting that Russell did on the right called The Trapper, which was obviously inspired by Remington's work. His first sculpture, done in 1903, called Smoking Up, was obviously inspired by, I won't say a copy, inspired by Mr. Remington's Coming Through the Rye, which was exhibited as a huge plaster monument in St. Louis in 1903 at the World's Fair, the exposition in St. Louis. And that's where Russell would have seen it. And that's his first sculpture, Smoking Up. A little bit about ethnocentrism. Both have some accusations about ethnocentrism. Russell, early on, painted these two pictures as a pair. The one about with the Indians is called Plunder on the Horizon. And they're stealthy, and they're lurking around. But the guys on the right, the white guys, are standing upright, statuesque, pointing, trouble on the horizon, a bunch of Indians, they're getting in the way of manifest destiny here. And notice that the tree has fallen across the path. It's not only the Indians, but nature that's gotten in the way. It's a slow, slow deal. But these were painted as companion works. This is that big painting we looked at originally, the Dash for the Timber. To count the number of riders, there are 8 riders there. The Indians are somewhat marginalized, but in lots of Remington paintings, the Indians have the prominent position, and the people being attacked are Anglos, and they're marginalized. But in this, we just look at the 8 people here. 5 of the riders are Anglo, 2 of the riders are Mexican, and 1 of the riders is Chinese. So for Remington, there was no separating. And then we've looked at his account of African Americans. Those paintings come all the way through into the 90s and early 1900s. And he just loved Mexican vaqueros. He went to William Randolph Hearst's ranch in Mexico in 1893, and he painted the Mexican vaqueros. He said, this is where the American cowboy comes from. And so he celebrated those riders throughout his life and career. In terms of gender, both of these paintings were painted as pairs. In Russell's eyes, the male and female had equal roles. The men hunted the buffalo, the women set up the camp, the women had all the hard work, and the women were dominant. All Plains cultures were matriarchal. The women owned all the property, the men only owned their horse and their weapons and clothing. This is one of his masterpieces in the wake of the buffalo hunters. You notice the little boy, he's looking off into the distance where there's a buffalo hunt going on over there on the right. But the two women, the grandmother is pointing the way. She's the one with the knowledge and history about this land, this country that they're riding into. The young woman with a baby in her cradle board standing above the horizon line, though, is the champion of all the tribe. She is the matriarch of this situation. And this is one of his great celebrations of womanhood in his Western paintings. He loved to paint courting scenes. He loved to paint scenes of Indians grooming. Remington said he never painted women. But of the 3,000 works that he did, 300 of them have women as subjects. And they're never demeaned or diminished. They're always at least on some par with the men that are in the scenes with them. And if they're in the scenes alone, they are given a presence of their own, as in this scene. This is the men hunted the buffalo. The man had shot this buffalo. But the women are given the chore of skinning the buffalo, of harvesting the meat, and bringing it back to nourish the tribe and family. So they have a very vital role and are just as important as the men. Russell does fall from time to time into this odalesque kind of scene. It's sort of a Victorian kind of habit. But one of them's called Kaoma, and one of them's called Waiting But Mad. I like the second one better. Remington sort of had an arm's length to romance in this scene of the love call. The woman's way off in the teepee there somewhere. So nothing direct. They both had happy married lives. Nancy on the left, Nancy Russell, was the dominant major force in their family. She managed him as an artist, and he was left to do the creative thing. She stayed out of that, but she managed his business and his life. And you could see doing business with Nancy was not easy. Eva, she just stayed out of things. But she was a very nurturing spouse, and they both had long lives together. Neither couple had children, although the Russells adopted a young boy in their later life named Jack. We've talked about this cult of masculinity at the beginning of the talk, and you can see it comes down to whether the cow has a brand on it or not. What the Remington painting is called What an Unbranded Cow Has Cost, and the Russell painting on the right is called The Cinch Ring, and it's all about stealing other people's cows. It's a bad thing to do. You don't want to do that. And you're lucky if you have any survivors in these shoot 'em ups. But in all, they were incurable romantics, both of them living in their remembrances, many of which came from history, scenes that they'd never seen. Russell had never known a real mountain man. Remington had never known the Plains Indian and the buffalo culture and the years of their ascendancy that come out in these two pictures. In 1914, Nancy Russell gave a talk to the women's club in Great Falls. And she said of her husband, no man can be a painter without his imagination. He must live in his pictures. Remington's last assessment of himself was that he represented something very special in American art, and that was he had a narrative essence in his paintings. He just didn't paint impressionist and post-impressionist paintings. They had to have a story. He said, I'm one of the imaginative men. And so at the end of their careers, they both agreed with each other that the imagination that they brought to their work was the paramount thing, that they created this myth, but they had enough of a sense of the reality of the West to give it some sense of credibility as well. So they both then started out preserving facts. They both ended up in celebrating the past and being as much creators of the Western myth as purveyors of its actualities. So here's to both of them. Anybody want to shift sides? Well, I hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you, Mr. Hassrick. We now have time for a few questions. Please raise your hand and the microphone will be brought to you.
Hi, thank you for the wonderful talk, first of all.
Thank you.
You separate the room into three fan groups, like the Remington fans, the Russell fans, and then the people who are neither.
I didn't say dealers. I said the people who don't like either one.
Yeah. Right. I assume you're
not. Maybe dealers. I don't know.
I assume you're not in that group, but do you consider yourself a Remington fan or a Russell fan, or are they about equal to you?
You know, I've been sort of targeted niched into being a Remington scholar. My first job was at the Eamon Carter Museum, and went into the vaults. Mr. Carter had collected huge quantities of Remington and Russell paintings and sculpture. So we went into the vault, my boss took me in there, and on one side was Russell, and on the other side was Remington on paintings. And he said, we just had the scholar on Russell write a book for the University of Texas Press on our Russell collection. And he looked at me and said, you're gonna be Mr. Remington. This is your side of the vault. And so I got assigned to, in a year, produce a book for Harry Abrams in New York on Frederick Remington. And when it came out, I became the Remington guy. There were other Remington experts, but I became one of them. And so I've always been sort of on that side. I've written a book for the Smithsonian American Art Museum on Russell. I've written books on Remington and Russell together. I like them both for what they were. You know, there's sort of a genuineness and a humanity to Russell, and there's sort of a hard edge, I'm a real artist kind of thing in Remington. But they both loved what they did, and they both were dedicated to preserving this scene, and I guess I'd be in the middle. And so if I had to join this group, it would be because I can't decide.
You mentioned earlier there was a shift in Remington's artwork. I was wondering if you could explain why there was a shift, if there was something that caused that.
Well, Remington had a national audience, and he lived in New York City. That was a lot more pressure than Russell, who could live out in Great Falls and paint for essentially a regional audience. So staying up with the current trends in American painting and sculpture was important for Remington, even as an academic painter. And so his work went from a sort of French realism to Impressionism. Later in his life, he said, Monet, Claude Monet is my hero, to what I think in many of his really late works becomes almost post-Impressionism, all with the undercurrent of that narrative, that imagination that he was so emphatic about including. So that would be, it would be pressures to stay up with the current trends in art. Even Russell stayed up with the trends in art. Maxfield Parrish, you know his work? Very bright, bold colors. Russell started enjoying Maxfield Parrish prints and reproductions, and so some of his Western landscapes reflect Maxfield Parrish's work. So even Russell stayed up with the currents, but Russell considered himself always in his life an illustrator, though he went well beyond that, and Remington didn't want to be continued to be looked at as an illustrator. He wanted to be looked at as a fine artist, and in order to do that, he had to sort of stay up with things.
Hi, once more, thank you for speaking. Like, you're awesome. But I'm just kind of curious. So when they did paint, what medium did they use? Because some of the paintings looks acrylic, and then sometimes in the background almost looks like a watercolor kind of thing.
They both painted, if we're just talking about paint, they both painted in oil and in watercolor. And they were both really quite masterful in both those media. Remington, when he was making the switch around 1900 to become a real painter instead of an illustrator, would paint in pastels, or would use pastels. And pastel is a very soft, kind of velvety medium. And so it was more an impressionist tool, and he wanted to see what his work would look like as impressionist works. And it was from that he evolved into his more impressionist kind of paintings. So I don't think I've ever seen a pastel from Russell, but they were either watercolors or they were oils. And then I don't even think I showed a pastel, but they're quite brilliant. Oh, here's a hard one, I bet.
Thank you. It was a wonderful, wonderful talk. What's a buffalo soldier?
Buffalo soldiers were the African-American cavalry after the Civil War. Many blacks moved west to find something to do. Some of them became cowboys, and some joined the army, and they were made into units of the U.S. cavalry. And the U.S. cavalry 9th and 10th divisions were African American. They were always managed by Anglo sergeants, or not sergeants, but lieutenants or above, but there were two or three of those units in the West. And they became called, the Indians called them the Buffalo Soldiers because their hair was kind of frizzy and looked like a buffalo. That's what I heard. I'm not a student of there. Yeah.
Thank you. Can you talk a little bit about the tension between the depiction of the Indians that the artist portrayed and the displacement situation? Did they reflect any of that?
Well, Russell did, yes. He was very much in favor of if the white guy had never come out here, we'd be in a lot better shape. That was his disposition on it. But it was a fait accompli. There wasn't a lot somebody like Russell could do, so he helped establish the Chippewa and the Cree into the Rocky Boy Reservation, which he pushed for. So he was very much for that. Remington, Remington's a little tougher. He sees the Indian as a romantic resistor of civilization, but then he, at the end of his career, he writes books and short stories and starts painting pictures that have the Indian is really celebrated. He was there at Wounded Knee, the massacre at Wounded Knee. Yeah. Remington was there, but not on the day of the actual massacre. He left 2 days before. And he's camped out with the with the soldiers. And when the action really comes down, most of his paintings are sort of from the perspective of the cavalry. I don't think it was viewed as a massacre until a bit later, maybe several weeks later, that this was really unnecessary kind of a treatment of these people, these Sioux people, and that it had been a lot, women and children had been killed in the process of this quelling of this so-called of this cult, and so Remington starts off on that side, but it's very soon that he begins to morph into more of a defender of the Indian people and understanding their ways. He could never get philosophically involved with Indians. For some reason, there was such a cultural difference until late in his life, and I think it was an invented reformation for him to start thinking of them as people who are equal and just as important, and their culture is just as important. And he writes The Way of an Indian, and if you read that book, it's very defensive about the way the whites have treated Indian people and very much on the side of the Indian. So they've both, by the end of their careers, come to be supporters of Indian people and their culture, but in terms of the political situation, it was already too late. I don't know if I answered that.
Hello, I was just wondering if you could speak more on the author's imagination, how much they use their imagination in when creating these scenes, both in the backgrounds and in the actual action of the scenes. And because we talked a little bit yesterday about like the real and the imaginary and the myth, and I just wonder if you'd speak about that.
Yeah, these like these cavalry charge scenes that Remington does. He'd obviously been part of that. He'd seen that. It may not have ever seen an actual charge of cavalry against somebody else, probably Indians, but that's the kind of drill that they would do, and he watched army drills and cavalry drills, so that there's a fact there. Putting him into the scene itself is probably all out of his imagination. He didn't see Lieutenant Carter P. Johnson crest the hill there and shoot at the Cheyenne, but he heard the story, so that came from his imagination. And the same with Russell. Mrs. Russell, when she was talking to the Great Falls Women's Club, she was talking about a little later in her speech. She talked about Charlie would get these the equivalent of writer's cramp. he didn't know what to paint next, and so she'd pack him a lunch, and he'd ride out of town, and he'd go to a local ranch, and he'd climb up on a haystack. And he would sit there and he'd just look at that scenery, the scenery that you see in the painting on the left. And he would look at that scenery and he would just start thinking, what could have happened here? Who would have ridden through here? What story does this landscape tell? And then he would paint a picture like this of mountain men he'd never seen surveying the streams for beaver. But that would have happened and he painted it, so it's totally out of his imagination. Does that help?
Hello. On bronzes, you did mention that Charles Russell had about 53 sculptures that he created. I didn't catch how many Remington had. And did they carve the bronzes in a wax and then cast them? And were there, I know there was at least one limited edition of, I think, Russell's, where there several copies were made. Is there more than one that's like that? Or are they all single editions and then the mold was broken?
That's four questions. let me try to answer them in this order. Yes. Yes, no, and yes. Okay, Remington cast 24, or copyrighted 24. Bronzes in his day. Some, as I said, like the Bronco Buster was real popular, the first one, and as many as 250, 300 maybe casts were made. A lot of casts were made subsequent to his death. His wife, his widow, was given the rights to cast them during her lifetime. He died in 1909. She died in 1918. So there's some posthumous authorized casts that were done. And then the foundry was supposed to break the molds and cast no more. Didn't happen. So they kept pushing them out until the 50s or 60s. So it's a little hard to tell, but we kind of know the records of the foundries. Both of them used primarily Roman Bronze Works foundry, although Russell and his wife used a couple of foundries in California. Late in life, Russell's moved to a home in California. He never saw that. He never lived in the house, but she did. And so they used a couple of foundries. She used a couple of foundries there, and she also continued to cast his work until she died in the 40s, I think. So they would usually use clay, although Russell had a habit of modeling with beeswax in his pocket, and he could sit and talk to you for a while, and he would be fiddling around in his pocket, and he would pull out a rabbit. And you'd say, "My gosh, Charlie, that's wonderful." He said, "Yeah, now I'll do a buffalo." So he was very facile. And if you've ever looked at photographs of his fingers, they're tapered at the very end. So very delicate hands for a cowboy, very delicate hands. And he was very facile. And his bronzes tend to be smaller in size and more sort of spirited in execution. They were both cast in bronze. And they were not limited editions. That doesn't mean there may have been one or two that were limited to one cast only for somebody, but mostly it was an open-ended edition, and they just kept making them. And then Remington monitored his bronzes very closely with Roman Bronze Works. Russell was much more lax. Mrs. Russell, after he died, was more attentive to quality control than Charlie had ever even been, and Mrs. Remington could care less. She just wanted the royalty checks. So those posthumous casts are with Russell's, they're almost as good or better, and with Remington's, they begin to deteriorate a little bit. Was there another question in there?
Whether he used a wax, which you covered that, yeah, whether he used a wax or like we do lost wax casting in our
yes,
business.
That's what they use.
And yeah, we do silver and gold castings, and we make the model, and then you do the reverse. A lot of people don't understand how that's done, but and then you end up with a final product after reversing it back and forth. And so I didn't know, but if wax was available back then, or if they used a clay, and you did mention a clay, so
yeah,
that clay could be burned out.
Yeah.
Once you make
the
mold.
No, the mold is the clay. They make the mold. They make a mold on the clay. But they would also, some of Russell's were done in wax because he liked to work in wax. And early on in Remington's career, in the mid 90s, he used lost sand cast with a foundry called the Henry Bonnard Foundry. Up until about 1900, and then he began to use lost wax with the Roman Bronze Works Company. Russell worked almost exclusively when he did casting in New York with Roman Bronze.
We have time for one more question.
Make it a little easier, okay?
You know, the third way to say Colorado.
Let me get this down.
Well, what you do is you develop a very thick Austrian accent, and you say Colorado.
Colorado.
But we spent a portion of our life in Gilpin County, and when we think of Colorado, or a lot of other people think of it, it's not Plains Indians or Buffalo Soldiers. It's mining. And there's a lot of artwork floating around Colorado on the mining culture in Colorado. Did Russell or Remington venture into that particular aspect of the West? Or were there other famous artists that painted the culture of the mining community and the rowdy? Miners were far more rowdy than anybody else in the...
You know, I don't know of either of them really painting mining culture. There were painters of There was a guy named Learned in Colorado who painted this. He would paint basically little city views of the mining towns, not so much of the rowdy miners. During the 50s, 1850s, there were some California painters who painted the California Gold Rush social scene and painted the miners on their good days and their bad days, and painted how they were taking gold out of the streams. But I don't think Russell or Remington ever got into that. Their Mythic West included other people, and Remingtons were cowboys and military and Indians, and Russells were cowboys and some Indians.
Thank you very much.
Sure.